Hello everyone, myself Shruti Gupta, Institutional Development Executive at Office of Alumni Affairs, IIT Kharagpur. I'll be presenting before you the first webinar of the Institute webinar series. Institute webinar series is an initiative of public relations cell of IIT Kharagpur to bridge the gap between the speakers and the students in terms of sharing of knowledge and experience in both ways. The first speaker of the Institute webinar series is Dr. Roy De Silva, President of IIT Foundation and Board Member of Pan-IIT. He is also the recipient of IIT Kharagpur's Distinguished Service Award 2012. Dr. Roy will be delivering a session on leadership, importance of alumni networking and giving back. Dr. Roy is involved with fundraising and has helped obtaining significant donations over the years. Roy has helped grow startup operations and corporations in USA and India into multi-million dollar business units. Dr. Roy De Silva obtained his bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from IIT Kharagpur in 1974. He was a boarder of R.K. Hall and has represented his hall in hockey, water polo, and dramatics. He also held positions in Hall Council. The public relations cell hopes that this webinar will help in the development of the knowledge of students and faculties and will bring active engagement of alumni and stakeholders of our institute. So here we present Roy, Dr. Roy.
I should say good morning to everybody, and as a point of clarification, Shruti, thanks for the introduction, but I do not have a PhD, so I am not a doctor. So while I did graduate from IIT Kharagpur with a B.Tech in electrical engineering, I then went on to do an MBA and worked in India for 8 years before I came to the US. I think that is that information is very relevant in what I will be presenting. And as you pointed out, I'll try and do a brief introduction to three very large topics. The first being leadership, the second being networking, and the third being giving back. So I do hope everyone can hear me, if not hear and see me. So with that said, I would like to start the first topic, which is about leadership. And I think I would start this really by probably preempting a question in a lot of people's mind is, you know, are leaders really born or are they made? And the second one is, when do leadership traits really start appearing? And what are these leadership traits? Or, you know, how do you observe leadership traits in people developing and what they are? So the answer to the first question would be probably both. Both is a safe answer, but it's not just being safe. I think every leader has certain traits which they are born with. And if you look at most leaders, I don't think you can look around and find a leader with less than adequate IQ. I mean, most people have a very good IQ behind them. And I think the second thing is that you have leaders who are always very energetic and passionate. And I think these two traits are very, very important, and really you are born with a lot of them. The second aspect of, you know, whether leaders are made, and I think there are a lot of leadership qualities which can be taught and which can be developed. And when they are developed and when they are taught, I think starts right from very early age a very early age. And I will try and go through the various stages of a person's life, because I think all of us can relate very well to our life cycle and where they are. And in the early stages of one's life, I think it's a very important part where the self-confidence is built up. So in the early years, if I was to ask which people influenced our lives early on in the early years, I think the unanimous response would be parents and teachers are the most influential in our lives. And the what happens is, you know, I'll give you certain scenarios, whether it's a parent or a teacher. One person can promote the sense of inquisitiveness versus one person or one style of parent or teacher can promote a good listening child. And I think there are, when you become a leader, the very, very important trait is one of inquisitiveness over listening. So the point I'm making is that even in the early stages, you are developing attributes of a leader. I'll also give you another example. When, you know, a child is being developed, you're looking at, you know, let me give you the example of a child in a swimming pool. Now, one style would be a parent in the pool asking the child to go ahead and jump off the side of the pool. And another parent on the other side would say, the parent is in the pool, but they're encouraging the child to swim before they attempt to jump off the pool. Now, what the first parent is doing is really talking about encouraging a child to take a risk. And once again, this attribute for taking risks is being inculcated or taught to the child in a very early stage of life. And you'll find in many of the readings where you go through on leadership, you will find that risk-taking is a very, very important trait that all leaders tend to show. So let's go on, you know, to the next phase of life, and let's look at the student years. And if I was to look back to my student years, I think the focus of students in the student year is academic excellence and extracurricular activities and being able to do some kind of a career planning. So when I look at academia, the first trait of a leader is, can you learn and can you inspire learning in others? Now, I do not believe that in my career I've seen or witnessed any leaders who cannot learn themselves and who cannot inspire learning in others, because that is also a very important trait of leaders. The other thing is, you know, while you're a student, I think it's very important that you don't only just learn, but you try and postulate a never before tried solution to a problem. This is what, even at a very young age, you will demonstrate leadership qualities. And I'll give you one particular example which I was exposed to. I was in an MBA program where break-even analysis was being talked about and some of the limitations were being talked about. And a student came up with a very, very novel idea for addressing some of the limitations of the techniques using calculus and partial differential equations. Now, this had never been ever tried as a solution to break-even analysis in business school. And that's what I'm talking about when I say you provide leadership in unique solutions, even at the student level. Now, I've given you one example from academia. Now, let me move on to another very important part during a student's life, and that is excellence in extracurricular activities. Now, we've seen people who are excellent players, and we've also seen people who are excellent team captains. And I think if the example which comes to my mind is about, you know, when Michael Jordan, who was considered one of the great basketball players of his time, while he was a great athlete, I think his greatest contribution to the team came when, under the leadership of the coach, he really became not just a great player, but he became a great team leader, because his role changed to become a helping hand to each and every of his teammates. And really, that's what makes the difference between an individual contributor and a great leader of a team. So you have to demonstrate that type of attribute to transcend from being an individual contributor to a great leader. So then let me go on to talking about, while you're in your student life, you're also talking about a career. And I remember, in my case, in the 70s, there was the energy crisis or oil crisis at that time. And I figured that if this was a big crisis, I took a very engineering approach and said that if this is a problem, then the solution to the problem has to come with a lot of R&D effort going into alternative energy. And there will be a boom in this industry and it'll open up a lot of avenues for engineering R&D, which I was interested at that time. In reality, that did not happen. And while there seemed to be a logical process in terms of vision, the boom really did not take place. And later on, I learned that it was because of structure of markets. However, at that time, consciously or unconsciously, what I did was also look at the courses, the business-related courses which were offered, and I kind of hedged my bets that if alternative energy didn't pan out, I need to hedge my bets and look at the business options which were already proven to be lucrative at that time. So it taught me a great lesson in vision and planning, which said that for every major decision, there needs to be contingency planning. So I think these traits can be developed and learned in the very early stages of life. And leadership training and experience goes on not just, you know, when you get into the workplace, but it starts much earlier. And they are visible to people, whether you're a student, whether you're a young person, or you're a student, and it actually starts before you get into the workplace. Now let me move on to a few phases in the workplace. And I'll start out with the first phase, which is an entry level. And when you get in at the entry level, you are really an individual contributor. Now, the question I have is, can you really demonstrate leadership qualities at when you're an individual contributor? And my answer, having observed a number of entry-level employees and being an entry-level person myself, is yes, you can. So let me give you an example. When I was guiding some entry-level employees, I asked them very clearly, and I told them very clearly that you're an entry-level employee, but my request to them was, do not be satisfied with the best practices that you see. I said, you're coming into the job, observe the best practices, and as far as you're concerned, the best practices are what are being followed at the company which you're in at the time which you're at an entry-level person. But you should not be satisfied with the best practices and investigate options which have never been tried before and see if you can promote those options and get them adopted. And I can tell you from my experience that when we started to question the best practices, we found in a lot of instances, even the Planning Commission in India and the Electrical Manufacturers Association were using forecasting models that had no statistical validity at all. And these entry-level people went and developed groundbreaking planning techniques which were adopted by the company. So the fact that they went out and did something that was never before done and never adopted either at the Planning Commission level or at the Indian Electrical Manufacturers Association level was a great achievement. So they showed leadership even at the individual contributor level. The next phase, time goes on and you move on from being an entry-level person and become what is called a supervisor or first-level manager. And really what you're talking about is you develop some experience and you want to impart some experience to a person or a couple of people who you tend to supervise because you have a little more experience than them. Now, the question here is, can you be a leader amongst two people? So, the primary job over here is you tend to impart your experience to the persons that you supervise. And it's your first exposure to dealing with people in the workplace environment. So it's very important that you establish your superiority because of your experience and your knowledge. And in addition, you must learn to work with people, not only as individual contributors, but also as the first team. And I think just like at the entry level, you had to innovate, I think that trend continues. But the leaders in a supervisory role, and if you put 10 leaders, I think the leadership traits that are demonstrated is when a supervisor goes to the manager, which says, you know, I am managing two people now, but, you know, I can't be a supervisor all my life. And what is it that I need to do to become a manager? And ask your manager to let you participate as a supervisor in some of the managerial roles that he performs. This shows proactivity, and it also shows that you are willing and you in your current job to prepare yourself for the next level of management. And the next level of management then comes up, right? And you see that you're not just a people manager, you're required to be a people and a budget manager at the next level. So what you have to do is not only have your technical skills, your people skills, your budgeting skills, but you need to also now start having all the right answers, because as you go up the ladder, what tends to happen is that you are considered the expert and you are expected to have all the right answers. And I'm saying this because the next level of management, which you will be interfacing with, you're now in a position where you have your general manager sitting on, you know, on one end, and you have your people and your budget or your resources on the other end. And you have now to be answerable to both sides. And it's very important that you have all the answers, because guess what? The general manager is going to be asking you all the right questions. And one of the general manager's most important traits is to be able to, you know, ask all the right questions, because asking the right questions is really the responsibility of the general manager. And it is a very important leadership trait, because the general manager oversees a lot of functional departments. Now, the other key attribute is that of when you're in a general management position, you're looking at a leadership trait, or you need to demonstrate a leadership trait, is not just to manage or innovatively during growth cycles, but it's very important to manage during adverse economic cycles. Managing in growth cycles is very easy, and I've for people who are familiar with components or with semiconductors, which I am with, you know, I've always said that in growth times, I can hang a shingle out and say DRAM's available here, and all my inventory will sell out. But in a downtime, you know, managing a demoralized or less than motivated workforce and making them to give their best is a challenge. So it is very important that you show leadership skills in managing during downtimes And that is very, 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 very important and distinguishes leaders from what I call just bosses. Now, in a downtime, you know, one of the very, very important aspects of leadership is to be able to motivate people. And to motivate people during a down cycle is extremely important, because you need the best performance out of your team. And that's why it is extremely important. And I'll give you two examples. Coming from a sales and marketing background, you'd always look at, okay, I've made a plan and I want to grow X percent. In a down cycle, generally, you are not either not achieving that percentage growth, or forget about growth, you may not even be at the same zero growth. In fact, most of the time, you're at minus growth. Now, when you're at minus growth, do you wheel the whip and tell people that, hey, you know, we've planned at X percent growth, and here we are at minus percent growth, all you guys are just useless, and, you know, the consequences will be, you know, whatever? Or do you look at it and say, you know what, we recognize that there is a market downturn and we need everyone to, so we are revising our metrics to say that we will compensate or reward people for achieving a market share which is better than our competition. So there are two ways that you tend to manage, and most leaders I've found have been very successful managing in using the second way of motivation. You then now have a motivated force and you have people who are working, you know, to do their very best, as opposed to saying, oh, you know, nothing's going to happen, so, you know, why bother? I then move up to the next level of what I call the C level, which is generally about people who are CEOs, CXOs, CFOs, etc. And I think the CEO and many C-level have to really have a vision. And it's very important that leaders in this group, they don't just have a vision, they also have the capability to communicate that vision, not only just to colleagues, but to the front line, because one of the most important leadership traits is to be able to have a great vision. You need to be passionate about that vision, and you need to be able to communicate that vision, not just to colleagues, but to everyone in the organization. Because generally, you are taking a position where no one has ever gone before, and you need to make sure that every single employee is committed to that particular vision. So it's extremely important that C-level managers, they not only have a vision, they inspire risk-taking. And they genuinely feel that that vision is going to be of benefit not just to the company, but to the employees and to its shareholders. So they have to address this vision and satisfy all the entities in that corporation. And it is really people who will take it to the next level. Now, the one thing that I think every leader should do, which no matter where in the career cycle they are, is to be able to celebrate the success of their teams. And people have financial rewards and non-financial rewards, and you know, in good times maybe financial rewards are possible, in bad times maybe non-financial rewards are possible, but in good times and in bad times, people, leaders, need to take the time to celebrate success. And I think these are very, very important traits of a leader. Now, you know, I've shared with you some of my observations and experiences, but I think it will be, you know, in half an hour's time, it's very, and having three topics to cover, it's very, very difficult to give you many, many examples, because I believe that examples demonstrate the theory much better. But if you're interested in leadership, I would really recommend just a small chapter from Jack Welch's book, who was a chairman of GE, in his book called Winning, and also a book called The Leadership Engine by Noel Tichy. So please take some time and read just these few chapters from this book on winning by Jack Welch, and I'm sure you'll find a lot more examples over there. And there are plenty of books and websites which you can do on leadership. And with that, I'll move on to the next topic, and I'll look at the topic of networking. And with networking, I'll say that it is very, very, very important to establish the right networks for what you want to do in life. And I'll start out with some of the, you know, I tend to have this life cycle concept, and because I've had experiences in my personal life where, you know, I've neglected some aspects of networking. So let me start with the family network, because that's your closest network. I think it's very important that you look at your family network, your parents' families, etc., because I am sure when you look at your family network, you will see wide experience right there in very close proximity to you, and they are the people who will go out of their way to help you. Do not neglect your family network. I'll give you a very simple example, which just happened a couple of days ago, and this is with my son. My son was applying to a company for a job, and of course he never ever told me what he was doing, and it just so happened that, you know, a day before he went for the interview, he told me that he was applying to this particular company, and I'll call it Company X. And it just so happened that I knew the CTO of that company on a first name basis, and he was at, you know, his final round of an interview, where all the technical part of it was all fine. It was just a matter of personality. You know, if you have two candidates with exactly the same technical capabilities and managerial capabilities, generally what tends to happen is that the person which has a familiarity tends to get the job. And I brought this up because I was talking about neglecting family networks. And it's very important that you keep in close touch with your family network. It's also very important that you keep in touch with your teacher networks. They are very, very important influencers, and they are very important people who guide you through very important parts of your career. The next part of it, you tend to go into a workplace and you tend to look at your professional networks, because if you have a problem which you're working on, as let's say as an engineer, and you're well connected with engineering professionals who are working on the same or similar problems, 10 heads may be better than one. So it's important to get, and people's points of view are different, and that's why we have various solutions to similar problems. So keeping in touch with your professional network is possible, and there are various organizations which you can be part of while you're in your professional networks. Then you have your social networks. It is important that you participate in social networks, because a lot of people tend to discuss not just your social part of your life, but they tend to, when people get together, they also tend to talk about their professional part. And so it's important that you keep a good social network going. And, you know, I'll give you the simple example of a golf course, where if you're a member of a golf course, you may run into people who are in the same industry or industries which are very complementary to you, which you may never be able to address or be familiar with in just your professional network or your family network or your network of teachers. So it's important that you also maintain a good presence in your social networks. And one of the last things I would suggest in networking is about, you know, being part of community organizations, because here you get people of various aspects of life. And let me tell you, on the boards of community organizations, you have mostly people who have been, you know, in high places, both professionally and socially. So if you ever go to a job counseling or program, whether it's in the United States or anywhere else, one of the most important things they will tell you is that you must have the right networks, because it is very important in the age where most job applications go via the internet. It's very important that you be able to get your resume on top of the pile. And the only way you do that is through having very good connections and networks. So with that said, I'll move on to the last topic, which is a topic called giving back. And I will first throw out a formula called is a formula which I created from observation, where I say the formula runs as follows. If if you look at the history of individuals, most people who have been very successful, they have added giving back, and in doing that, they have become very, very respected. Whether you look at the Hewlett-Packards, whether you look at the Bill Gates, or you look at the Warren Buffetts of the world, what they have done is, first, they've been very, very successful. Then they have got involved with giving back. And I think when you add those two together, their position of respect went from very low to very high. And I think we talk a lot about success and how to be successful, but I think we do injustice to a very important part of what is called giving back. So getting to the giving back part of it, I think it's important that you can give back at every stage of your life. And there are two very important components of giving back. One is time and one is money. And my experience, having been associated with nonprofits from the India Community Center here, which has grown to be one of the largest, to being involved with the alumni associations, both as a volunteer, individual volunteer, to becoming the president of the local chapter, to becoming the national president of IIT Foundation, and also being on the board of Penn IIT. I think it is the aspect of time is extremely valuable, if not more valuable than the dollars which are given. Both are very important. Some people can give a lot of time, can give no dollars. Some people can give no time and a lot of dollars. And in between, people can give time and dollars. So whichever position you're in, be sure that throughout your life, if you can give back and add that to your success, you will become a very, very respected person in your community. And I think it's very important that early on you decide on a cause that you would like to support, because you have to be passionate about the cause that you're supporting, because it's not only about you giving back. When you go out there, you're an ambassador of that cause, and it is very important that you not only give back, but you encourage people to give back for the cause which you are committed to. This is the multiplier effect which you as an individual can do to multiply giving back for the particular cause that you support. Now, getting more down to earth, when you talk about time, you have to be a volunteer. You also have to take on a leadership role. There is a time and place when you feel that you should be a volunteer, and there's a time and place where you feel that you're equipped to lead. And don't feel that, you know, a volunteer is not a leader. A volunteer, in my opinion, is the single most important part of any organization which is not for profit. So please volunteer and get as many people that you can to volunteer along with you. In terms of giving back, as I said, in terms of money, there's always a time and place and affordability. But no matter how big or how small your contribution in monetary contribution is, trust me, every single nonprofit will appreciate whatever you do. And in the Americas, you know, a kind of average norm is about 2%, but that's just the average norm. It is extremely appreciated whether you volunteer your time or you volunteer dollars, but do take time to volunteer. And I think, you know, my opinion is that students are alums from the day they spent 24 hours in IIT Kharagpur. And you have the dean's office, and you can do a lot of volunteers if you sit down with the dean's office and decide on a role that you'd like to play in terms of giving back. IIT Kharagpur has put together a great strategic plan, and there are roles for everybody in there. So please take the time and work with your dean's office and establish a role. Before, you know, wrapping this session up, I would also like to recognize the Gopali Youth Welfare Society at IIT Kharagpur, which I found out about when I visited Pan IIT. And what I said was about, you've got to establish a cause that you would like to give back to. And I'm extremely happy that this organization exists right within IIT Kharagpur. So with that said, I would like to thank everyone for their time. And if there are any questions you'd like to ask me either now or in the future, the Dean's office has my email, and it's a very simple email. It's roydesilva@yahoo.com.
Thank you, Roy. Thank you for this wonderful session. And thanks for correcting us on the PhD part. And we started getting a few questions, but as the time is constrained, so we started getting the questions from our listeners, from our viewers, and a few of the questions which we have chosen, a few of the good questions. Gaurav wants to ask you, as you talked about leadership at early stage, and you mentioned that parents and teachers play a role there. So what would you like to say to the professors of IIT KGP regarding this?
I think the professors have to take some time to inculcate leadership, the leadership traits which I described. And they are very important influencers in developing leadership traits. So I think it's very important that they consider, you know, a professor, you know, take for instance, you know, the business school, you know, does leadership training. Can they put together a course of, you know, what are leadership traits which can be recognized and how they can be developed for students? So does that kind of give you one answer to that question?
Yeah. Can we move to another question?
Yeah,
the second question Amit wants to ask, that you talked about risk-taking during leadership, and what would you like to say to the budding entrepreneurs of IIT-KGP?
You know, I think the ability to take risk is a very individual thing. For budding entrepreneurs, I say that you should take risks, but you should also take very calculated risks. Do remember one thing: mortality rate of startups is very high. If I was to quote some statistics, you know, only about 5% of all startups really become successful. So you have to recognize that going in, and you have to do a lot of due diligence, and you have to be very passionate that what you are going after will succeed. If it fails, it's not a failure. There are many factors that result in failure. Do not consider it as a failure of your performance. However, look at the learning experience that it gave you and apply it in either a next startup or in the corporate world. Those experiences are never going to be taken away from you, and it is most important that you learn from those experiences. So, you know, when I was, you know, I worked 8 years in India. I came to the US with wife, two children, and no jobs. That was a huge risk for me to take. So, but I took that risk, and I did come here. And fortunately, I did succeed. So risk-taking is something that you have to do, but you also have to learn how to balance your risks, depending on the situation where you are in. In my situation, I balanced my risk by, you know, me being in a startup environment of a corporation, and my wife being in a startup. So as a family unit, we balanced our risk. So you, when you're in an entrepreneurial mode, you also have to have, you know, you have to take the risk, you have to take calculated risks, and you have to balance your risks.
All right, the next question is from Rina, and this is the last question which we have chosen. As you know, the alumni giving back to ITKGP, the history is long and historic. But usually we witness this after 10 years, 20 years down the line, after alumnus or alumna graduates. What can be the motivation for young alumni to give back to their beloved institute?
I think young alumni have to recognize one thing, that they did a lot of hard work and they got admitted to IIT. The IIT is one of India's jewels, and coming into IIT was just one part of their journey. What they got out of IIT will be valuable throughout their life. So I think it is important that they learn while they are there the importance of giving back to an institute which has done so much for them. And I think this is, you know, a lot of it is what I call an appreciation for what you have received during your stay at IIT Kharagpur, and that should be motivation. I think it is very important that people go and see examples of what alums do even after they graduate, but it is important that they realize that they can contribute even while they are there. So I think it's really an internal self-searching that you have to come to believe in, that yes, my days at IIT were really good days, and I had experiences which I could never have gotten in any other place, and I got this at a reasonable cost, and I should do whatever I can to make this a better place. Because I'll tell you one thing. When I came here, IITs was not known over here. When, you know, it was only in 2003 that the IIT brand took hold, but it was with a very great effort that we made that happen. It was through the first the global conference, which was held in 2003. Now, when I look at India and I look at the number of IITs coming, you know, starting around, I think it is very important for everyone, every alum of IIT Kharagpur, to create the IIT Kharagpur brand. And it is, when you create this brand, you will find that tomorrow, when you go to the corporate world, they will not ask which, you know, whether you came from IIT or not. They will ask you, did you come from IIT Kharagpur or not? Okay? And it is very important that for you to do whatever you can so that IIT Kharagpur is the premier institute in India. And that is a legacy which has to be established. It is not sufficient anymore for you to be from IIT. And you will only realize the significance of that, you know, when it may be too late. So the time is now for everyone to realize that they have to give back, whether it's branding, whether it is being an ambassador to go through to every coaching class in India and promote IIT Kharagpur over anyone else. It is very important because ultimately it is the IIT Kharagpur brand which you are going to be attached to in India. It will take much more time for that to happen in the US or overseas, just because, you know, it's just a little too much for people to go out and brand particular campuses. So I hope that that point is made, and why it's important to give back, and why even a student should decide on giving back.
Thank you, Roy. Thank you for this. Once again, thanks for the wonderful session. And we are extremely happy to have you as the first speaker of our webinar series. In the short time you have been here, you have really helped us in giving us a wonderful start to our endeavor.
And I wish you all the very best in this series. And if there is anything I can do to help this series go along, because I do believe that there is a lot to be learned from these webinars, especially when you conduct these with people who are very close to students and to IIT Kharagpur. So with that said, would you like me to sign off?
Thank you, Ron.
All right. Thank you very much, and thank you for your patience.
Yeah, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Take care.